Thank you, Brother Michael. I'm thankful tonight to have the advantage of following the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 20 and verse 7, since I am the last speaker of the evening. The text says that he preached until midnight. So, being the last speaker, of course, I do want to follow his example in other ways. But I am thankful to have the privilege of being here this evening. My family and I to be with you this week. We thank the Lord for this privilege. And thanks be to God for the Bellview Church of Christ, the godly elders, Brother Hatcher, and the godly wives that back these men up, and the congregation here. I'm so thankful for each and every one, all the faithful and sound brethren here tonight and during the lectureship. Certainly we want to pray for all those mentioned, Brother Stancliffe, Brother Chumley, Brother Van, and also Sister Joanne Cruz, a member of the congregation where I preach. She is battling cancer. Please keep her in your prayer also. You know, friends, I don't want to be like the preacher who went to try out at a congregation. And he preached for 30 minutes. So they hired him. And first Sunday on the job, he preached for 15 minutes. Everybody was happy. Well, the next Sunday, he preached for an hour and 15 minutes. So they called a business meeting. They said, "What happened?" They said, "Well, the first Sunday, I had all my teeth pulled and couldn't talk good. And my first Sunday on the job, I had my new false teeth, and thus I couldn't speak very long. Said, this morning I got in a hurry and accidentally picked up my wife's teeth and got up to preach. Just trying to help Brother Bruce out there a little bit. You know, kind of bear some of the brunt there. But our topic this evening is Ecumenism. Ecumenism. And this is a movement promoting unity among Christian churches or denominations, number one. Or number two, more largely, a movement promoting worldwide unity among religions through greater cooperation and improved understanding. Now, one thing I would like to say to begin with is that number one leads to number two. If not, why not? If we can break down and erase the barriers in the doctrine of Christ that would separate people, why can we not even break down the barrier of the deity of Christ? If we can deny the way that we're to worship God and the plan of salvation, the organization of the church, why do we even have to recognize that He is Lord, that He is the Son of God? So this movement just keeps on going. And thus, if we transgress the doctrine of Christ in one area, then what would be keeping people from doing it in other areas to the point that they would embrace Buddhism and Islam and Hinduism and every world religion? And of course, all of this is wrong. One word in this online dictionary that I like that's used as a synonym, and I believe that it really describes things, and that is the word inclusive. The word inclusive. That's a key word when you think about ecumenism or the ecumenical movement. Inclusive and tolerance. Tolerance. According to the Bible, we are to prove all things. That is, we are to test all things according to the Scriptures. And then that which is approved of the Scriptures, we are to hold fast. We are to hold fast that which is good. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. And we are to hold fast the form or pattern of sound words, Paul said to Timothy, which thou hast heard of me, in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. Now, the first question we want to ask regarding ecumenism or the ecumenical movement, is this the unity for which Jesus prayed in the very shadow of the cross? He prayed concerning all who would believe on Him through the apostles' teaching, for whom He had been praying, "Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thy Father art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. Now there are two things here to consider. First of all, this prayer is for all who would come to true faith, and not some kind of faith or belief in Catholicism or other forms of denominationalism or sectarianism. And the reason for this is because he prayed for all who would believe on him through there, the apostles' word. Now in Acts 2 verse 42, we see what the apostles' word was. There we read, the inspired Luke records, and they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrine, and in fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. It was not a doctrine or teaching originated by the apostles, but that which they preached that came from Jesus Christ. And we know this from John 16 and verse 13, because there Jesus promised the apostles that when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. The all truth is the apostles' doctrine, the doctrine that they preached, that the Spirit, the Comforter, guided them into. Another description of it is given by the Apostle John in 2 John verse 9. There John said, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. And thus the prayer of Jesus here is not a prayer for those who would profess to believe in the Lord, because even the demons believe and tremble or shudder, James 2:19. There are many people who believe in the Lord, but it's not true biblical faith, because faith without works is dead, being alone, James 2:17. And moreover, what has produced their belief is not the true doctrine of Christ. Therefore, the Lord's Prayer in John 17 here, which is often misconstrued, is not regarding Christendom at large. It is for those who would truly believe on Christ through the teaching of the apostles. Now, Paul said in Romans 10:17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And thus, true faith comes from the true word of God, or the true word of Christ. Now, another thing to consider here is the fact that the nature of ecumenical unity, so called, is not the same nature of the unity or oneness for which Jesus prayed. Jesus prayed for a oneness or unity such that exists between he and the Heavenly Father. Now, the so-called unity between various religious bodies or throughout the denominational world is that in which there are differences in practices and aims and purpose and belief. Can we ever imagine that there would be a difference between the Father and the Son regarding organization and work or opinion or love and purpose? Or any of these things? Certainly not. That is the nature of the oneness for which Jesus prayed. That we would be one according to the oneness existing between the Father and the Son of God himself. The unity for which Jesus prayed here is that which Paul describes in Ephesians 4 verse 3. When he taught the Ephesians, and by implication us too, as we know, that we are to endeavor, that is, give diligence to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, it is the unity of the Spirit in that it is the unity and oneness which the teaching of the Spirit produces when we obey the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit, Ephesians 6 and verse 17. But ecumenical unity is more like that which was at the Tower of Babel in Genesis 11, 1-9. We note that they were in agreement, They had a purpose. They wanted to make a name for themselves. And, you know, if you look at some of these people today, caught up in unity and diversity and the brotherhood and the ecumenical movement at large, a lot of these people want to make a name for themselves. They're more concerned about their name than they are the name of Jesus Christ. They're more concerned about their respective religious bodies than they are the body for which Jesus died and shed his blood. The church of God, which he purchased with his own blood, Acts 20, verse 28. We know at Babel, they did join together. They were in agreement, all right, but the problem was, and it's a big problem too, they were not in agreement with God. And so today, when we see people that are supposed to be in the brotherhood have these unity and diversity efforts, and when we see ecumenism in the religious world at large, well, they may agree and agree to overlook their differences and wrap their arms around each other. As Jeff Walling said several years ago, throw a calf rope around them. Isn't that foolish? But yet, none of these are in agreement with God. Now, as we go further, as we look at ecumenism, it does not seek to dissolve man-made religious bodies and doctrines in preference to the truth, but to find common ground and agreement with one another. Despite their distinctions and doctrines and practice, and in spite of their disagreement with biblical teaching itself, this is not true unity. And one thing we want to say is that Jesus did not have the ecumenical spirit. If you turn to Revelation chapter 2, for example, in verses 14 to 16, according to the ecumenical spirit, you know, this spirit that, you know, we ought to be inclusive, we ought to tolerate people even though they're living in sin willfully, although they're disregarding biblical doctrine and morals, we ought to have enough love just to wrap our arms around them. If you read Revelation 2, what the Lord said to the church at Pergamos, you see that the Lord was not ecumenical. He rebuked the church there for tolerating those in sin. He said, "But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth." The Lord's word to them was, let us not, it wasn't, let's have a unity meeting, let's get to know each other better. But his word to them was, repent or else. And that's what people today need to know who are in religious error or moral error, whatever it be. Jesus said, "I tell you nay, but except you repent, you shall all likewise perish." Luke 13, verses 3 and 5. Now, my friends, let's look at God's word versus the spirit of ecumenism. We know that the ecumenical movement is said to be of or relating to the international movement initiated among non-Catholic churches in 1910, aimed at Christian unity, embodied since 1937 in the World Council of Churches. Now, the very fact that denominations are involved in this in itself shows that the ecumenical movement is flawed from the very beginning. Because denominationalism, by its very nature, is divisive and contrary to the New Testament. We see, though, that the danger of the spirit of ecumenism existed long before the 1900s or the 1800s. We see the danger of God's people being drawn into this idea of unity and diversity, or the ecumenical spirit, all the way back as we read the Old Testament regarding the children of Israel. If there was not a danger of this, then why in Deuteronomy chapter 7, the first six verses, did Moses say, inspired of God, in verse 2, And when the Lord thy God shall deliver them before thee, thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them, and thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor show mercy unto them. And then, in verse number 6, it gives the reason. For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. And because of this, he had said to them also in that passage, thus shall ye deal with them, ye shall destroy their altars, and break down their images, and cut down their groves, and burn their graven images with fire. You are to tear down every semblance of their false religion. You are to completely destroy it. Is that the ecumenical spirit? And why were they to do this? Because you are a holy people unto the Lord your God. Now, what does that tell us about the ecumenical movement? It tells us that it's an unholy movement, and it is not for God's holy people. In 1 Peter 1, verse 16, be ye holy, for I am holy, the Lord said. Because we are a holy people unto the Lord our God, sanctified, set apart, separated unto his high and holy purposes, then we are not to intermingle with worldliness and the ungodly things of this world. Now, moreover, if the church, the Israel of God today, in the figure, Galatians 6, verse 16, becomes joined with Roman Catholicism, Protestant denominationism, or any other false religion, it will have the same spiritual consequences as Israel had in joining with the idolatrous Canaanites. That is, we will lose God. Now, in Ephesians chapter 4, we learn that there is one body and one spirit, even as you are called in one hope for your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But according to the unity and diversity in the ecumenical movement, we don't have to just recognize one baptism. We can tolerate and accept others. We can recognize other religious bodies, not just one. And certainly we can be inclusive or more than just one faith. But yet, friends, if we would go to heaven, we must be possessed of the Word of Christ, not the ecumenical spirit. As we go to the book of 2 John, we know that the apostle of love, as he is called, John, didn't have that ecumenical spirit. He said in 2 John, beginning at verse 9, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ, hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. Now, friends, today when we stand on that, even in the more current, cutting-edge unity and diversity movement involving Dave Miller and Memphis School of Preaching and Mac Deaver and all this mess, when we stand for that, of course, we're accused of having the wrong kind of spirit. But if it would apply to Rubel Shelley and the likes of Jeff Walling and Max Licato and others, why would it not apply to all those in error? You see, if we're going to abide in the doctrine of Christ, we have to stand against everything that is contrary to the doctrine of Christ. Not just those whose names have already been marked in the brotherhood, but those whose influence is infiltrating sound and conservative congregations, which is doing the most damage today. Moreover, the Apostle Paul did not have the ecumenical spirit either in Ephesians 5, verse 11. When he said to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Nor when he said in Romans chapter 16, verse 17 and 18, now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them, for they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. But now let's turn to 2 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, if you have your Bible. And here we have some words, beginning at verse number 14, that have to do with fellowship. Paul said, "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial?" The three words here that are related, fellowship, concord, well, actually the idea of communion, agreement, all these are related. And this is a negative here. Paul is saying we cannot have fellowship with these things. Now, someone might object and say, yes, but he's talking about paganism, idolatry, and fornication, and all these things, and that's true, he is. But again, if we can let down the doctrine of Christ in one area, the area of morality, or the area of worship and serving only the Lord our God, and non-idolatrous religion, why can we not break it down in other areas? Why can we not violate this principle of having fellowship with that which God does not approve in everything, if we can do it in one area? But now let's look at some specific ecumenical efforts among churches of Christ. We know that Jesus said in Matthew 15 and verse 9, "But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." And then in verses 13 and 14 of Matthew 15, "But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up." He said, "Let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch." Now, many, as we know, have fallen into the ditch of unity and diversity. Many have fallen into the ditch of the ecumenical movement. And this is not to say we shouldn't try to reach out to these people and bring them back to the truth. Certainly we should. But the idea of having fellowship with them and trying to just disregard these false doctrines and compromises of the current day. Jesus said these words, "Let them alone." Now, if they insist on following things that are not in the doctrine of Christ and refuse to come back, what are we to do? Are we to reach out with them in the ecumenical spirit? Or are we to do what Jesus said? Let them alone. You know, we have preachers and congregations today that just can't stand the thought of leaving certain schools or prominent brethren alone. They just can't stand the idea of, "I'm going to have to leave them alone? You mean I'm going to have to go on and live without their support? And without them being behind me?" Yes. If we're going to stand for the doctrine of Christ, we're going to have to let them alone. The swapping of pulpits, joint activities and social or moral causes, joint worship services, common memberships and ministerial alliances, and clergy associations and unity meetings are prime examples of promoting ecumenism among brethren. In the past 30 years, we know that there has been a special push to have unity between churches of Christ and the Christian church. One of the leading efforts along this line was what is called the Restoration Summit on the campus of Ozark Christian College in Joplin, Missouri, on August 7-9, 1984. Now, when one studies that movement, and there were several other unity meetings every year following that in different places between members of the Churches of Christ and the Christian Church. But a similar effort had taken place on May 3rd, 1939 in Indianapolis, Indiana, between Churches of Christ and the Christian Church. But there was one faithful brother there, and I'm not saying he was the only one, but his speech threw cold water on the fire of that unity meeting. And his name was Brother H. Leo Bowles. His speech was printed in a tract form entitled The Way of Unity Between Christian Churches and Churches of Christ. It was made available to those at the 1984 Restoration Summit. But Alan Cloyd, one of the leaders and chief instigators of the summit, he actually disposed of those tracts. What a horrible thing to deprive these precious souls of much needed and valuable teaching material. Evidently, Claude was more concerned with his own agenda than with the truth. I'd like to read a small excerpt from Brother Bowles' speech. Brother H. Leo Bowles said this, and it applied, of course, to the Joplin Summit and to any such effort today. And I would encourage us to find that speech if we don't have it. It can be found at therestorationmovement.com. It can be seen there. He said, let all do faithfully just what God has required. And let all do this in the way approved of God. And unity is the inevitable result, and no conference or unity meeting is needed. This will reduce all religious worship and service to its original divine simplicity and purity, and will restore to its original efficacy and power to save. In this simplicity and purity of worship, and in perfect harmony with the will of God, the richest blessings of God will be ours. Faith unites men to God and one another. Opinions sever them from God and one another. Opinions are the occasions of endless strife and bitterness. Brethren, let us not be deceived. Let us not have a misguided zeal for unity that blinds us to the only way which leads to God in unity. What a fine statement that was. This entire speech. But the story is not over there. Brother Guy in Woods, I'm thankful that Brother Harold Davidson put this in the good book that he wrote, Over the Horizon, about Brother Guy in Woods. And glad that he and Sister Davidson are able to be here. But he provides this information. Of course, I knew that this happened, because after hearing of it, I went up to the Gospel Advocate office. And I went in to see Brother Woods, and then I confronted Neil Anderson about it. So I knew about this, but I appreciate the fact he's got these facts in the book form that he does. But Brother Guy in Woods, editor of the Gospel Advocate at that time, opposed the 1984 Restoration Summit in the pages of the Gospel Advocate. And this eventually led to his dismissal, and that's the thing I was talking about that happened. And I believe it was 1985, mid-1985. He was dismissed from the editorship by Neil Anderson, the publisher of the Gospel Advocate. Before that, however, Brother Woods wrote to Alan Cloyd, questioning him regarding the disposal of the tracts, to which Cloyd replied, I did, in fact, remove the tracts in question. They were uninvited materials which were not appreciated. Well, he certainly didn't appreciate the truth, did he? Let me go on. Brother Bowles' language is abusive and crude, Claude says. Now, friends, I read that to you. Was there anything abusive or crude about that? You know, Brother Claude just didn't tell the truth. That was wrong, what he said. He said, I did not feel that these tracts would be in the interest of the meeting. Well, sadly, the attitude of Alan Cloyd toward faithful men of God like H. Leo Bowles and Guy in Woods And their sound teaching is characteristic of many today, and the attitude that many have toward faithful brethren at this lectureship is also characteristic of this. People that are not as far out as Alan Cloyd have the wrong attitude toward those who will stand for the truth. But after charging Timothy to preach the word in 2 Timothy 4:2, Paul said, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust will they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they will turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables." And I'd like to look at another example here before we close, just very few minutes. Even some well-known brethren who do not agree with the use of mechanical instrument of music in worship embrace the idea that those of the Christian church denomination are our brethren and express an ecumenical spirit, at least to a certain degree. In a 2006 interview with the Christian Chronicle, Brother Phil Sanders, a writer on the spiritual sword, speaker on In Search of the Lord's Way, made the statement, "There are likely some societal and moral efforts which estranged brethren can find some common ground." Now, if you've been listening to the lesson tonight, does that fit with the ecumenical definition that we've been talking about? Hand in glove. "We could fight against the dangers of immoral behavior or the secularizing of America together." Why can't we do that as the Lord's church? That's what we're here for, to fight for the truth and to fight against evil and error. He goes on to say, "There may be some relief in charitable efforts comprised of people from many faiths working together." You know, that really does sound like the ecumenical spirit, doesn't it? And then he also stated this, "A century of disruption in fellowship means many members of both groups know little about the other. It has not been important to them because they are unaware. Leaders and members need to know their history and heritage, the good and the bad. How do we win our brothers back?" Proverbs 18:19. "We will not do this by ignoring each other. We will win some brothers back the way we lost them, one at a time. We must talk at some point and pray at some point." Pause there for a moment. You know, at some point, they need to repent. Repent or perish. That's what Jesus said. "This is not the time," I'm picking up the quote here, "for name calling, but rather for calling on His name." Again, there's that ecumenical spirit. "We treat our brothers as brothers even when there is a disruption in fellowship." 2 Thessalonians 3:14 and 15. "One sister in the Christian church I taught about musical instruments had never heard the reasons why we don't use them. Once she learned the reasons, she gladly embraced the truth. We didn't rebaptize her." He said, "We did not rebaptize her." That's significant. "We embraced her on her repentance. I can only speak for myself here. I believe baptized believers in the independent Christian church are my brethren, since everyone who is scripturally born of water and the Spirit is a child of God." Now, as we close, and this will be the invitation too, I want to go over to Acts chapter 8. There are many passages that will refute the error that Brother Sanders taught right there. That all a person has to do is to be baptized supposedly with the right mode and purpose, and that makes one a brother in Christ. Friends, that's not true. Because a Christian church is not the only one that may do that. Let's go to Philip teaching the Samaritans in Acts chapter 8. In Acts 8, verse 5, "Then Philip went down to Samaria and preached Christ unto them." He preached unto them the Christ. And in verse number 12, Now, this will refute this false doctrine. That all one has to know is the purpose of baptism in order to become a Christian. That's not true. We have to do as Paul said and declare the whole counsel of God. Acts 20, verse 27. Teaching them, as Jesus said, to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Matthew 28, verse 20. And verse number 12 here in Acts 8 in Samaria. But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God, what's the kingdom of God? The church. Now, the Christian church is not the church. We enter the kingdom of God and the church at the same time by water and the Spirit, John 3, 5, 1 Corinthians 12, 13. And in the same way, we submit to the same teaching to enter the church as we do the kingdom, and we're under the same King and Head, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Thus, the church of our Lord and the kingdom of God are one and the same. But they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ. A lot of these people out here in the ecumenical world, they say, oh, well, what's in the name? What difference does a name make? Some of you fellows ask this young lady you want to marry you, that you're really crazy about, and you think she is about you. But she says, I'll marry you, but I want to wear that other fellow's name over there. Would you marry that girl? Well, Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. But not only that, the name of Jesus Christ is an all-authoritative name. And we've said that all during this great lectureship, and all these speeches have been outstanding. Paul said we're to do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Colossians 3:17. Philip taught them that. The authority of Christ and his all-authoritative word. Now, does the Christian church do that? When they allow mechanical instruments? The missionary society and other things? Do they teach the authority of Jesus Christ according to his holy word, who has all authority in heaven and on earth, Matthew 28:18, to answer the ask the questions to answer it? And then, of course, the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. So you see, friends, we'll conclude tonight, we cannot be taught wrong and baptized right. And moreover, we cannot be taught wrong and enter into the church of our Lord. And so I want to close where we began. True believers are those who believe on Jesus Christ through the apostles' word. John 17, verse 20. The doctrine of Christ. And it cannot be admixed with the doctrines of men or denominational error. And B, the apostles' word. So tonight, if we have any here who need to come, having heard the word, you believe. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. Hebrews 11 and 6. Faith leading us to repent, have a change of mind, leading to a change of life. To repent and turn to God and bring forth fruits worthy of repentance. Acts 26, verse 20. Come confessing the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, Acts 8, 37. And then arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord, Acts 22, 16. And the blood of him that loved us and washed from our sins in his own blood will cleanse your sins away, according to Revelation 1 and 5. And thereby we will put on Jesus Christ, Romans 6, 3. Galatians 3:27, and be saved, Mark 16:16, and the Lord will add you to his church, Acts 2:47. Or if you have left that teaching, tonight you need to come back to repent and pray God's forgiveness, Acts 8:22. We invite and encourage you while we stand and sing together.